He was a program director and project manager for kind of the council of students of promise, both the achievement gap initiative. And in this role, he provided project management and technical assistance and program development to Garfield, Maple, Warrensville, and Cleveland Heights University High School District. This is where he is right now, man. I'm sorry. And so he's been doing this with schools, and he's getting ready to expand his program. And he has a brochure that he's showing me back in the office about students of promise. It says what parents, educators, and the community need to know about a program that helps students get back on track and reach their full potential. Very nice brochure. I know he's been working with young people for some time. He used to work for the county executive down in Cuyahoga County. He's now a consultant down there. He then went out to the San Francisco area where he launched and implemented the Student of Promise program in that area, in the school district out there. And so he's worked in a number of places, including for the governor of the state of Ohio. And so he founded this Ivory Educational Consulting Group, okay? And so he's a businessman, owning his own business, very involved in the community, and he's really focused on helping our children. And so we're very pleased that, and if what you read, the other things he's done, product of the Cleveland Public Schools, with Ohio University, you know, some of you might connect him to Reverend Ivory, who used to be here. Reverend Ivory used to be here at the Rector of Bell Court many years ago. And so Bob is part of that family, he's a musician, songwriter. And, but the thing that I've been really been impressed with, and I ran into him about 6 or 7 months ago at a program that Congresswoman Fudge was doing for youth, to just hear the feelings about youth and what they're dealing with out in the community and with all of the things that are going on in the community. And he was one of the people that was present there. And when I was leaving, he handed me one of his books. And his book is simply titled What God Has Done, a book that he has written. He's an author, and it's an excellent book. And at the end of service, during the reception in the back, he'll have some of these books that will be for sale. And it's a quick read, short chapters, but he really hits on some things in life that really, really, really struck me. Bob, I thought it was an excellent book. It's an excellent book. It's an inspirational book. It tells you about his journey, some of the things he has overcome. And let me tell y'all something. We all got to overcome something, amen, in life. Amen. And we have to make a decision whether or not we are going to be overcomers, okay, or underachievers. But this is a man who is an overcomer. He certainly is an achiever, and he's done so many great things. And I'm happy that he's agreed to come be with us today. And the next voice you will hear as I take my seat is that of Brother Bob Ivory, who will come to talk about, he's an inspirational speaker. And you know, this book is about inspirational messages for daily living. And I need to be inspired, amen, every day that I get up, amen. When you look at what's going on around us in the world, we need somebody to speak into our spirit in a positive way. So Bethany, give a warm welcome to Brother Bob Ivory as he comes to you. Amen.
Good morning, Bethany.
Good morning.
Good morning, Bethany Baptist Church. If I could ask the musicians to continue, and I'm going to put in a selfish plug from one musician to another, you guys are rolling, and I would like to keep the spirit flowing. If you could just allow the Spirit of God to continue to manifest itself. I am just honored to be here. Pastor Rowan, First Lady, Sister Rowan, and the young people that officiated this youth celebration, Recognition Day. It's just a privilege to be here on this sunny day today. I wanted the music to continue because I was just so overjoyed in seeing that the youth and young people basically, you know, took over the service today, and I just got chills. And some of those chills were welcome because it kind of takes some of the focus off the steam that I have in my shoulders from the sunburn on Wednesday. I'm serious. I took off, which is not, but I'm literally, our son, you know, beat me up like I was in trouble watching those Cleveland Cavaliers in that parade. How about those Cleveland Cavaliers? Kind of got, I'm sure we maybe just got our voice back a few days ago, but I just appreciate being here. And I also want to say that I believe happy anniversary is appropriate as I believe 9 years, is that correct? 90 years, still got a hand. 90 years of service to this community, and has provided, you know, so much to so many, for so many years. And I would like to also bring greetings from my church home, which is Antioch Baptist Church on 89th and Cedar, where Reverend Todd Davidson is the pastor. And I would be remiss not to say that Bethany and Antioch, there's some history there. There's a robust history there. There is some illustrious history. And I guess it's like that song said, we go a long way back. I don't know how long, Pastor, but I do know we go a long way back. I believe I see us have some family members here. I wanted to at least acknowledge some of my family. I see my son and my grandson, and a little shout. But I'm going to ask any family members to stand up. I'm looking across and see my son, Timothy, my grandson, Perry. Talk about my vision in a minute as far as how I struggle, but I just thank them for coming in and to celebrate with us this morning. I had real fond memories of Bethany Baptist Church. Let me just start with that. Very fond memories. I grew up not too far from here, about a few blocks north, just north on Church Hill off 105. So I can remember coming to Bethany as about 6, 7, 8 year old. A little boy for the Cub Scouts. You had a Cub Scout troop here. So I can literally remember walking, coming down 105, across the Superior, coming for Cub Scout meetings, and my little blue Cub Scout hat, and my tie, and the matching shirt with the bear on it, and you remember that? Don't look at me like you don't know what's out there. And the matching shorts came across to about here. I remember coming here for Cub Scout. I don't know how many badges and merit badges I had. I'm sure it was a lot, but I do remember coming here, and I remember like, wow, you know, that was cool. And I was cool, because look what I had. I had glasses, so this, I mean, young people, just feel me on this. I'm 7 or 8, I'm coming down 105 in Superior. It's 1973, and I got a blue matching hat on with glasses, and shorts that comes to about here, a tie, and merit badges all over me, coming to Bethany Baptist Church in that high school. I had to be cool or either know how to run fast, but still, I learned some valuable lessons coming here as a child that I still remember. And that's important. Scouting is important, and some of those lessons stick with me today. As the Bible says that you train a child as he should go, and when he's older, he will not depart from him. And I believe that that's very valuable. And as Pastor Roland said, my grandfather and your father, Reverend Roman, I clearly remember Reverend Roman. And I do remember my father directly. He's on the wire and stands here. I like something is missing. Because I used to sit maybe right around here. And there was a choir loft, because I remember sitting there and having to sit there. And I have one of those, sit there, don't move, don't breathe, don't swallow. Somebody knows something about that. While my grandfather participated with the choir. But also, I clearly would be remiss if I did not acknowledge. I see one of my oldest friends, and Roland Osborne, we started preschool together. And speaking of preschool, my preschool teacher is here. So if my allergies act up a little bit, I just told you my allergies are about to act up. But I saw her stand, my preschool teacher is here in the congregation. When I saw her get up, I wanted to run around. And I can't speak to a book and speak to a book without acknowledging the person that taught me how to read and write. Ms. Peck, will you please stand? Ms. Peck. Dawn Elementary School, I really got to be on point. Grammar and everything else. I appreciate you so much, Ms. Pat and Pastor Roman. Just growing up and just watching you, admiring you, and you may not have known that, but just inspired by you over the years and the closeness that our family has shared. That means so much to me, and I do not take lightly at all when you have the opportunity to speak to a congregation. It's one thing to speak at a high school auditorium and speak at a political event or speak at a community center, but to speak in God's house, that's another level. And for the man of God to allow someone to come and address his congregation and stand behind a sacred desk, I take that very seriously. And I appreciate you for that. And I have to say that I've been in meetings, and I think I was in some meetings not long ago, and your name came up. But someone said, you know, do you know Dr. Rowan, Pastor Rowan? We were talking about programmatic. So, you know, sometimes, Bethany, you can't let everybody know who you know. You know, sometimes you gotta keep some things, you know, on the low a little bit. So I didn't let them know that I knew Pastor Rowan, but I had my own little personal kind of pocket column on, you know, I had a little private in my hand. You know, they said Steve Rowan, in my head, on top of my pocket. I know Dr. Rowan, I know Steve. So God bless you. Give your man a God a hand, please. Thank you, musicians. You are great. Now, what I would like to do is just if I could park 1 second, and I just want to zero in on our young people as this is who we're here to celebrate. Like I say, it just warmed my heart. I work with teenagers a lot and in the school districts, and I have for a while, but to see teenagers, as many as I saw, and young adults here on a Sunday morning when they could be anywhere. They could be anywhere in the world. They were here in God's house being recognized and leading the service. So what I would like to do, if you would allow me, just for a moment, and it will be a moment. I don't have how you can time yourself, but I think I'll go by this. As Elizabeth Taylor said, their eighth husband, I'm not going to keep you long, but I'm going to try to keep you long. That worked in Saturday. I want to turn our attention to our young people, who I would submit, and I'm sure you would agree, are our most valuable assets, our young people. Young people often who through society and through media and through other elements are portrayed in a negative light. And sometimes we don't get to see their hidden potential, their God-given abilities, their determination, their greatness, and their genius within. Let me say that again, their hidden potential, their God-given abilities, their determination, their greatness, and their genius within. Now, Bethany, I think I just described maybe about 25, 35 of your young people. Did I not? Now, from growing up from not far from here, on 105, I know a little about something of having a family and a church that surrounds you, as my grandfather was a minister as well. But I just wanted to, just for a second, focus in on our young scholars, young leaders, distinguished young people, innovative, accomplished, hardworking, well-spoken, well-dressed, soon to be well-traveled. Sons and daughters of Bethany Baptist Church, and more than all, children of God. Amen. As we collectively celebrate you today, my message is really simple. It's this. You have found the feather. Now I challenge you to bring back the bird. You have found the feather. Young people, young adults. Now I challenge you to bring back the bird. Now I say this in conjunction with a belief I have that that it's God's will that you continue to enthusiastically pursue excellence. And as the scripture was so eloquently read, Colossians 3:23 says, "And whatsoever you do, do it heartily as unto the Lord, not unto men."
Yeah.
Whatsoever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord, not unto men. That's just profound to me. Now, although, young people, heartily is not a word that we hear often. Young people, if you haven't had a teacher said, "Turn in your assignment heartily," raise your hand. That's what I thought. Meaning, I just want to share with you that heartily is not necessarily used on the playground, in the classroom, on the workforce, on the block, but it simply means with great enthusiasm, exceedingly, energetic, downright. I think we didn't heard the word downright before, but that's one of those synonyms for heartily. Now, I just wonder where I would be, as I am you. I'm from the same blocks that you're from and some of the same experience, but I just wonder where I would be today had I applied Colossians 3:23, starting as a youth, entering into adulthood. Where might I be if I had applied myself heartily and downright? Now, I can definitely say the things that and things I should not have done that I did heartily and exceedingly and downright. I think we all can relate to some of that, can we not? But what if starting as a youth, as a child, as a young adult, that you approach whatever you did harder? I went on a field trip this past Friday. Took some of my students, took 44 students from our program. Field trips and exposure, it is a great part of our Achievement Gap program. And we went to visit the Amish country. Anybody ever been to Amish country? We went to visit Amish country. And I recommend anyone that has not, that is a worthwhile trip. But one thing that stood out to me is the reference after reference after reference from the tour guide and from the families we spoke to is their approach. And they had no idea that I was going to talk about this, and they had no idea I was going to reference Colossians 3:23. But what I kept hearing over and over again was their approach to everything they did, especially their work ethic, their community, and their faith, was with enthusiasm, with excellence, and with precision, as unto the Lord. So I think there's something to be said to the Amish that we can also share in their mantra that they have. So with that, I frame this message. You have found the feather. Now bring back the bird. Now, of course, this is a metaphor. And I'm not going to insult anyone's intelligence and language arts acumen, not about a metaphor, but young scholars, let's agree that a metaphor is a figure of speech and a word or phrase to an object or action in which it is not literally applicable. So therefore, I'm saying that the feather and the bird is a metaphor. We are not going bird hunting after church. I don't even know anybody that bird has. We do that on public churches. I don't think we did that, but I just wanted to use that as a metaphor. By no means am I suggesting, though, that the feather is anything light. So think about, you know, we have the term lightweight and feather, but I'm not suggesting that the feather is anything light or insignificant. Actually, Bethany is to the contrary. Because the feather on the bird, and especially birds that fly, we all know all birds don't fly, correct? Just like all dogs don't hunt, correct? Okay. But the feather on a bird is a big deal. Without the feathers on the wings on birds, say like eagles, that soar real high, that bird is not going too far, let alone is it going too high. Now, let me tell you something else about the feather. Although, I'm going somewhere here, this is not biology. Although the individual feather and the wings and the tails are light, and combined though, there are two or three times the weight of the skeleton, the weight of the bird's skeleton. The color patterns of the feather serve as camouflage against predators. I bet you didn't know that, Reverend Ron, did you? I also bet you didn't know we were going to be talking about this in the Sunday service. But also, the feather also acts as waterproofing and protection against the elements. Now, the elements. Now, the bird's feathers may go through wear and tear and are placed throughout and replaced throughout the bird's lifetime. Now, that is how I submit to you that the feather is no joke. So when I use the feather as a metaphor, you have found the feather. Now bring back the bird. This is what I'm suggesting. I'm suggesting that the feather, students, scholars, young adults, that the feather is your hard work. The feather is your preparation. The feather is your accomplishments. The feather is your liftoff, or what elevates you, and your elevation, and what takes you to higher heights. The feather is your determination. And the feather is your God-given ability. Amen? Now, just so I think we got it, can we say hard work?
Hard work.
Preparation.
Preparation.
Accomplishments.
Accomplishments.
Elevation.
Elevation.
Determination.
Determination.
And God-given ability.
God-given ability.
Okay, that's what the feather represents. Now, we got a different, you're going to see the feather flying around now, and you're going to look at it a little differently, I bet you, back in the day. So if that's the feather, then imagine what's the bird. If the feather is that, then here's what I'm suggesting that the bird is. The bird represents an end goal, your desired outcomes, your success, your rewards, and your enthusiastic pursuit of excellence and purpose, which God has for your life. Can we agree this morning that God has a purpose for our lives? For the young people that we saw, for the young people that were in the pulpit, for the young people that were the athletes, the young people that were the praise dance, God has a purpose for their life. So this analogy of this bird and this feather, it's bringing to mind a childhood story. Bear with me for 1 second, because as I mentioned earlier, all birds don't fly. Well, every summer, my grandmother and I, and my little brother and my nephew, we would go south. We'd go to Arkansas. Any racing backs in Arkansas now? Oh, okay. We would go to Arkansas for the summer. And after school was out, my grandmother was a teacher's assistant at FDR, Lynn Drive, not too far from here. So we would go to Arkansas, and I was from Lake Village, born in Lake Village, been there for a while. So I was born down south. I'm sure you can tell that from my southern accent by way of Churchill, but we would spend each summer visiting our relatives down in Arkansas. And then my great grandmother, whose name was Mama Dean, we would go down to their farm. And we're talking about farm with mules and hooking up horses and mules and buggies and plowing fields and getting the eggs out the coop in the morning for something. Am I talking? You like any rumors of that? That was my every summer. I don't even remember summers in Cleveland. I remember that going down to Mama Dean in Lake Dermot, Arkansas, on their farm. And chickens running all over the place. I mean, everywhere. Chickens in the yard, like we see squirrels running around up and down the street, up and down Hampton and Olivet in the church. Chickens running around all over the place. Even under the house. Why? Because the house was on bricks. The house were on bricks and blocks. It's called a shotgun house. Meaning, they call it a shotgun house because you can look in the front, just like I'm looking at that right there, you can see clear through the other end of the house. Now, I'm setting a stage and a backdrop for our young people, because a lot of our young people don't have this reference, would you believe? They don't have that grandma. What we had, it's changed just a little bit. Wouldn't you say? It's changed. Grandma's hands looked a little different than they did then than they do now. And somebody here knows about grandma's hands. Why are you laughing? Grandma's hands, not in judgments. That's not even right, because somebody's gonna leave here and go put on Bill Withers when they go home on the Lord's Day, and that's not right. But young people, you know that song too. All you gotta do is YouTube Teddy Riley in Black Street, because your diggity is Grandma Van. I'm not talking about what I'm talking about. But let me go back. The music, I would go somewhere else and start getting the music. So back to these chickens, running all over the place, underneath the house. Me and my little brother Ricky, we would actually play with the chicken. We would take a broom and take the straw. What about no smartphones and no DS2-3s and all that? No, we took a broom and a straw and would put it through the holes in the wood and the floor, and the chickens would grab it. So we actually played with the chickens that way. So one day, Mama Dean actually was out in the yard, we all in the yard, and she was in her early 70s then. And then we watch her, she literally, I see my cousins laughing, it's staying funny, because your dad, your uncle was down in the room too. He just had to work today, because I was putting him on the street. However, I saw my great-grandmother in her early 70s literally chase this chicken down. I'm talking about corner. I'm talking about, you would have thought she was in the paint like Kyrie and Jack. Chicken didn't have a chance. Chicken was just done. And the chicken gets to the fence and he's trying to, you know, you don't fly. He's trying to get over the fence, but he didn't make it. And so my great grandmother caught this chicken in mid-air. And she grabbed it and she had it and she ran. I'm not gonna get too graphic here because we're gonna have some kids on here. They never gonna eat chicken anymore. The chicken stopped moving eventually, let's just say that. Then she takes the chicken and she gives it to my grandmother, who had a tub, this big metal tub. And how I know and remember the tub, because me and my little brother used to take a bath in it, because there was no running water in the house. I'm trying to show to our young people where we come so they can have some reference, because I don't think they put this in the textbooks. But we somehow have to pass this information down. So I see my grandmother with this chicken, and she's plucking the feathers off, and she puts water on this, that, and the other. Okay, now it's dinner time. We're at the table with the rice and the gravy and the cornbread and the peas and the corn on the cob.
Yeah.
Watch this. And the Kool-Aid in the jar. And the chicken on the table. So I'm sitting there, Ricky's sitting there, I'm 7, he's 4. And my mother's serving our plate, we say our grace, and my grandfather, Mr. Roy, and we say grace. And then she's putting the rice and puts something, and then she grabs the chicken. And so Ricky looks at me kind of funny. And I look back at him kind of funny. And Mama Dean must have noticed our nonverbal communication. And she said, "What's wrong? You don't like chicken?" Ricky said, No, we don't eat that kind of chicken." So Mama Dean said, "Well, what kind of chicken do you eat?" And Ricky said, well, see, our chicken comes from the store. We was just playing with that chicken yesterday." So, to make a long story short, all birds don't fly, but we did have peanut butter and jelly that night. Because we probably weren't sure where the rice and gravy came from, but this, can I move on about, you found the feather, and now you found it, you bring back the bird. Remember that the bird is the end goal, and the outcomes, success, and the pursuit of excellence and purpose that God has for your lives. Now, there's three things I just want to say about how to bring back the bird, and then I'll take my seat. First, young people, you must see and believe in yourself as we collectively see and believe in you.
Amen.
You hear that, young people? You must see and believe in yourself.
Amen.
As we collectively see and believe in you. Now see, it's evident to me that that's already taken place, because you could just look at this congregation, you could just look at your pastors, you could look at your officers, you could look at the first lady, you could look at the ministries in this church, And you can say, if nothing else, if nowhere else, somebody believes in you. Somebody believes in you. Somebody believes you have value. Somebody believes you have merit. Somebody believes that you have worth. So allow me to support that if I can, Pastor Rowan, as Philippians 4:13. And you know how things touch and agree? Because I didn't know I was going to be up to the Brotherhood meeting them this morning. And then I look to my right, and oh snap. When you get over 50, you say things like, oh snap, and dude, and cool, and sharp. One of my students, we have blazers, and with our crests on, shirt and ties, and whatever program. And I saw some of my students when I came in to speak to them one day. I said, oh, wow, y'all look sharp. One of them looked at me, Mr. Ivory, sharp. Yes, you look sharp. But I looked over and I saw up there, Philippians 4:13. And I was here from the New King James Version. I can do all things. Help me out. Christ strengthens me. Do you believe that? Young people, do you believe that? I can do all things in Christ who strengthens me. Does it say, we'll talk about my vision a little later. But if I didn't have my context, I might mistaken that for I can do some things through Christ who strengthens me. And then if I have to adjust that this left eye is not good, I might mistaken it as I can do a little bit in Christ who strengthens me. And if I really had to do this one more time, I might mistake it, I can do something or another or just enough in Christ. That no, young people, you can do all things in Christ that strengthens you. So this is what I'm reminded of, that here at Bethany Baptist Church, where you got 90 years of devoted Christian service, we are supporting our children, our young people, with that premise that they can do not only all things through Christ, but they're also doing all things through, you're supposed to say it, all things through, begins with a Y, all things through, they're doing all things through you, all things through you as well. But with that said, young people, we also can allow ourselves to entertain any negativity. We can't entertain anyone saying what we can't do. Anything or anyone that says what we can't achieve. We can't tolerate anybody saying or placing any limits on you or your abilities or putting you in a box or painting you with a broad stroke or profiling you based on the color of your skin or profiling you based on the color, or profiling you based on the color of your skin. I read in Revelation 1:15, it says, his feet were like bronze glowing in the furnace. I'm saying this on behalf of some of our young folks who don't see themselves maybe as they should. But our Bible says, and I'm not saying my Bible because it was your Bible before me. A lot of you was yours before it was mine. So our Bible says, Revelation 1:15, that his feet were like bronze going in on the furnace. Now, have a look. Watch this. Have you ever seen a bronze metal? You ever seen a bronze? You got the silver metal, you got the gold, you got the bronze. If you haven't seen a bronze metal, just maybe you've seen a penny before, right? Help me out, man. Come on. Help me out. You've seen a penny. Penny is a close shade to bronze, right, Brother Sam? Now, take that penny, then, okay, and let it get into some fire and keep it in there until it's hot or turn red. Then let it cool off, okay? And the next time someone profiles you because of the color of your skin, or put you in a box because of the color of your skin,
or denies you opportunities because of the color of your skin, think in your head, Revelation 1:15, it says his feet
Amen.
Were like, somebody's gonna catch this and say, his feet were like bronze
Amen.
Glowing in a furnace.
Amen.
And when bronze cools off, it creates a color.
That's right.
And then ask yourself, even some adults here, ask yourself, have you ever seen anybody's feet that was the different color of their face?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I say that to you, young people, that you should continue to believe in yourself because you are made in the image
Amen.
Of God.
Hallelujah.
Now, as you believe in yourself, and I can speak this from experience, don't be discouraged, however, because there may become someone that you believe in, young lady, that lets you down. There may be a time where someone that you believe in that lets you down. I love basketball. I used to, my shoes is in the trunk. I love the Cavaliers. I'm not going to, in the Lord's house, tell the field when I was in San Francisco, and I was rooting for the Warriors. But I'm back rooting for the Cavs. But I said that to say that LeBron James let me down the other day with the language. He let me down. And we can't not say that because we were champions. All that wasn't necessary. He let us down. We love him, and we're going to lay love on him. But you have to say to your 7-year-old, your 9-year-old, your 11-year-old, your 14-year-old, we expect that from Donald Trump. We don't expect that from LeBron James. But young people, there may be someone who may let you down. It reminds me of this. There was this couple who was in the store shopping. They've been married for 50 years. 50 years. I just want to acknowledge anyone here that is had any 50-year been together. I just like to acknowledge folks and acknowledge greatness. But this, you had, oh, there we go. Give them a hand clap of praise. Give God praise. Amen. Amen. Well, this couple was in the store, and they were shopping. Been married for 50 years, husband and wife. And before they got to out the store, the security stopped them and asked the wife to empty her pocket. Lo and behold, she stole the can of peaches. So they end up having to go to court. And the judge stands in front of the husband and the wife. And he asks her, how does she plead? And she pled for everyone, no contest. So the judge found her guilty for stealing a can of peaches. So he says, before he gives out his sentence, he says, well, let me ask you this. How many peaches was in the can? And she said, rather remorsefully, she said, Your Honor, there were six. There were six can of peaches. Six peaches in the can. So the judge looked down his notes, and he looked at the couple, 50 years of marriage. And he said, well, I have come to my decision, and I am going to sentence you 6 days in jail. Y'all should say, aw. Y'all sound like she's gonna have more time now. This is rough, rough congregation. 6 days in jail for six peaches in the can? But he said, I'll do this though. I will allow your husband to say some words on your behalf. I will suspend your sentence based on what your husband says on your hand. So she looks at him and she smiles. And he looks at her and he smiles. And he looked at the judge. He said, Your Honor, yes, my wife of 50 years, yes, she stole a can. peas too. And a can of peas too. Young people, some people that you think they're gonna let you down.
Yeah.
You think you know them, they may let you down. But you have to keep going on a path towards someone who will, let me see, never let you down. God will never let you down. He's the same God yesterday. He's the same God today. He's the same God always. He'll never leave you and forsake you. So young people, even if someone lets you down, hold on to God's unchanging hand. Believe in yourself as we collectively believe in you. Now, number two, you found the feather, now bring back the bird. I tell you, there's so much touching and agreeing going on in here, it's spooky. Because the second way you touch or you bring back the bird after you found the feather, Maul G, we gotta hook up, man, that was hard. But you said in your song, realize, I got it written right here, I didn't just type this after I heard you sing. You have to realize, reel in, awaken, release your greatness and your genius within. Yeah. You have to realize, reel in, awaken your greatness and genius within. Now, Bob, what does that mean?
Well, I'm so glad you asked. I'll tell you.
That's another sign Roland is getting older. I'll be 51 on Tuesday. And another sign of getting old, not that 51 is old, see, I just forgot how old it was, is you ask yourself a question and then you answer it. That's another sign. You know, like what am I going to have for dinner? Let me see, I think I'll have some chicken. Chicken. But you ought to be nice and hungry after you leave this service, after all this reference to food. Somebody ought to be taking somebody out to dinner tonight with some rice and some gravy and some peas and some corn on the cob and some chicken and some peanut butter and jelly. You ought to be nice and hungry with all these references to food. But you have to, young people, release your greatness and genius within. What I mean by that is each of you are special in your own way. The definition of genius is an exceptional capacity of intellect, especially as it's shown in creative and original work. A good friend of mine, his name is Akil Marshall, works with my program. He has a book called Winning in America, excellent book, but one of his focal points in the book is Awake the Genius Within. Where are my middle school students? If you're in middle school, raise your hand. All right, if you're in high school, raise your hand. If you're in college or heading there, raise your hand. If you're in vocational school, raise your hand. If you're a young entrepreneur, raise your hand. Well, you might say that, my science scores are not where they want to be. I say, awake the genius within. No one in my family has gone to college or owned their own business. I say, awake the genius. And see, we all are work in project progress. And I challenge you, however, as you have found the feather, on your road to bringing back the bird, realize, reel in, release your greatness and genius within. And this is how I can say that with such confidence, Bethany, young people, because you come from greatness. You come from greatness. You come from greatness. Frederick Douglass, George Washington Carver, Harriet Tubman, Madam C.J. Walker, Booker T. Washington, W.E.B. Du Bois, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., Malcolm X, Benjamin Elijah Maine, Shirley Chisholm, Congresswoman Stephanie Tubb Jones, Mayor Carl B. Stokes, Congresswoman Fannie M. Lewis, Congressman Lewis Stokes, Congresswoman Lisa Wright, General Colin Powell, Congresswoman Marsha Fudge, President Barack Obama, First Lady Michelle Obama, Reverend Dr. Albert T. Roman, Reverend Dr. Stephen Roy. You come from greatness. You stand on the giants, on the shoulders of giants that have cleared the way for you, like cleared a way to the paint, like LeBron for Kyrie in Game 7. And if that is not enough, check this out. This is going to just blow you away. Greater is He that's in you than he that is in the world. And that he is Jesus Christ. So realize, really awake, and release the genius within. You still with me? My final point. You have found the feather. I challenge you to bring back the bird. But understand that there may be some stumbling blocks along the way. But they may actually be stepping stones to where God would have you be. I have to say that again, because I'm talking to myself right now. There may be stumbling blocks on the way, but they may actually be stepping stones to where God would have you to be. So from stumbling blocks to stepping stones. Can anyone here relate to stumbling blocks in their life? No, you can't, because everything's just been fine and great. And can you relate to stumbling blocks in your life? But you came to recognize, either through time or through wisdom or through prayer, or it might have been grandma's hands, that they were actually stepping stones to God's purpose for your life and to where He was trying to elevate you to be.
Yeah.
Our all-knowing, all-loving God may have you go through in order to get to what He alone has for you. The stumbling blocks may present themselves, for instance, in a myriad ways. They may present themselves in, let's say, relationships. Relationships are hard work, are they not? Yes, they are. Relationships are hard work. Be it family, be it personal, be it professional, be it significant others, be it a spouse. But the stumbling blocks may present themselves also as stepping stones to wholeness, forgiveness, acceptance, healing, clarification, reunification, transition, and togetherness. I don't know about you, but sometimes I've been my own stumbling block.
Amen.
Have you been your own? You've been in your own way, insisting upon doing it my way, Bob's way, young people, your way, instead of doing it God's way. What appears to be stumbling block or setback may also be a stepping stone to the comeback in disguise. You see, at some point, our personal pursuits should align with God's assignment. And this is what makes us complete. And the real definition, I believe, of what it means to be successful. See, success is not measured by the size of your home, the size of your car, your credentials, your degrees, your bank account, the organizations that you belong to, the company that you keep, the people that you know. True success is measured by the lives that you touch and impact, the lives that you stand in the gap for, with your abilities and gifts and strengths and compassions and loves and talent that God gave you, stepping stones. Yes, you may encounter stepping stones and stumbling blocks on your way to bringing back the bird. See, I was in college. I heard Ohio University mentioned. I was in college at Ohio University. Coasting through my sophomore year in 1984, good grades, they're above 3.0. I'm living the college life down at Ohio University. I'm not going to elaborate on what living the college life means at Ohio University, not on the Lord's name in this house, but I think, just take my word for it, living the life of a college student at Ohio University, then in the middle of the winter quarter of my sophomore year, my world changed, and my worldview changed, actually forever, because it was then, in my winter quarter of my sophomore year at Ohio University, as I was just coasting and things were just going cool, just that word again, cool, for me, until I learned that I was adopted. And who I thought were my parents were actually my grandparents. Stumbling blocks. And who I thought was my sister was actually my mother. Stumbling block. And as devastated and confused and caught off guard as I was, and all the other dynamics that would surface over the years from this revelation, the stumbling block I viewed, it was actually a stepping stone to a life, a path, a course, a destination that God would place me on. Stepping stone. Then, after I learned I was adopted, that can only mean the obvious, that there had to be another side to the whole story, right? Right? We don't just, so I know some animals don't need a man, but I think God made it where we need. There is another side to all of us, like it or not. There had to be another side, a paternal side, that I had no knowledge of, no one to help me find it, no one to help me fill in the blanks or willing to. All I knew was the name of my biological father, who was deceased. So I couldn't ask him anything. But nothing else, and very little to go on, to help me find out anything otherwise. Stumbling blocks, Bethany. But one day, years later, I was determined. Because I believe that if you delight yourself in the Lord, He will give you the desires of your what? Your heart. And I desire to know the other half of the whole story. I desire to know if I had any other siblings. I desire to find out if I had any other family. I'm not talking about somebody else in this room. I desire to know what he looked like. I desire to know what he was like. I desire to know maybe something about his parents. So one day, I just took a look in the phone book. This was 1989, Bethany. It wasn't no Google. It wasn't no Yelp. It wasn't no all these other things. It was that big thing that they would throw on your porch and your parents make you bring it in the house. It was the phone book. And God guided my hands. And right at my very fingertips, all along, I found the name of my father's widow. And I called her on the phone. She talked with me. She accepted me. She embraced me. And blessed be to God, she introduced me to three other brothers that I didn't know I had. One was in middle school, one was in high school, one was in college. And we bonded as if we had known each other our entire lives. That was a stepping stone. And although the Lord would take home one of those brothers on May 2nd, just a few weeks ago, at the age of 46, which left me and left our family an irreplaceable void. I wear this purple shirt today in his memory and his legacy as it relates to you. And Brother Fordham knows exactly what I'm saying, as he is the chaplain of Omega Psi Phi. As my brother was, I'm not. But I wear this purple shirt today in his memory, as I needed to represent his passion through me to you as it relates to the youth. As he was a principal of Carol Wood Intermediate School in Bedford. As we talked about youth, and we talked about best practices, and we talked about how kids can be successful, and what support systems parents need to be successful, and we would bounce these strategies back and forth while we were in the gym working out. Now we can never fit leg day in, but on that bench though, we would get it in. But the Bible says, absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And since I know and believe that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, whosoever believes in him shall not perish and have everlasting life. I believe that. You believe that? I believe that. Paul G. Ward Jr., he believed that. My other little brother, Clinton Hall Jr., who passed when he was 19 in 1992, he believed that. So what does that say to me? I will see them again.
Amen.
When I lived in San Francisco just a few years ago, I left everything behind in Cleveland for a love interest at the time. And I thought that was the right thing to do. Ultimately, it did not materialize to where we intended because there were unforeseen stumbling blocks. However, if I had not taken that leap of faith and left the comforts of Cleveland, I would have never had the opportunity to work with the mayor of San Francisco and several black leaders in the black community on critical issues from Bayview Hunters Point to the Fillmore on the out-migration of African Americans in San Francisco. It's stepping stone. I was initially told when I went to San Francisco and met with the school district that I could not implement the Closing the Achievement Gap initiative there as it was implemented here, and implemented successfully, by the way, in Ohio and in Cleveland while I was in the governor's office for Closing the Achievement Gap under the leadership of Governor Ted Strickland and former state senator C.J. Prince. In some meetings, I was just told flat out, it ain't gonna happen. They didn't do their neck like this, but I know what that means when somebody says something ain't gonna happen. Stumbling block, young people. I ran into a stumbling block. But after meeting and being led to Reverend Dr. Amos C. Brown, Reverend Rowan, president of the San Francisco NAACP, senior pastor of Third Baptist Church in San Francisco, the oldest African-American faith institution west of the Rockies, and one of eight students taught by Dr. King on the only course Dr. King taught at Morehouse College, Dr. Brown took me under his wing. I not only had a memorandum of understanding with the San Francisco Unified School District and launched the Student Promise Program in San Francisco at a school named Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Middle School, we took 17 eighth graders, raised $24,000, and flew them from San Francisco to Atlanta to witness President Barack Obama deliver the commencement address in 2013. Stepping stone. Also in San Francisco, one day in school, I noticed there was this black little veil at the top of my eyesight. About this much, it was black. I didn't think nothing about it. You know us men, we could grow a third arm and wouldn't think nothing about it. Somebody has probably contemplated that. Halfway through the day, it lowered just a little bit. Then, that evening, as I'm at a memorial service at church, it was like halfway down my sight. I couldn't see past halfway of my vision. It was not until I was going across the Golden Gate Bridge home from San Francisco to Oakland to get to Berkeley that my entire sight gone, blind in my left eye, driving across the Golden the Bay Bridge. Stumbling block, you think? Stumbling block. But after an emergency surgery for the detached retinas, that's what had happened, and 10 grueling days of recovery, suspended myself over the bed, meaning I had to lay like this over the bed, face down, for 20 hours a day, for 10 days straight, as the bubbles they shot at, 4 or 5 bubbles they shot in my eye, had to make one and go to the back of the eye. But they say the only way this will happen, and the only chance of you restoring that sight, is if you are physically able to do that. 20 hours a day. But the doctor, he didn't say anything to me about God's healing power. As I was healed, and now I have most of that sight back in that eye. But now I see better and more clear than my purpose for God has for my life than I've ever seen before. That's a stepping stone. That's a stepping stone. And finally, I just need to drive this from stumbling block to stepping home, stepping stone, to hope our young people can take maybe something from my experience based on it might be something that they experienced. You couldn't have told me in 1997 that I was not going to be the next Babyface. You could not have told me that. You think I'm lying? I get on that keyboard and make it, I can't do what he did. He was excellent. And I've been in the studio with Brother Sims over there, God bless his heart. But you couldn't have told me in 1997 that I was not on my way. I had the best entertainment attorneys and manager from Warner, Electric Atlantic, 50 years of experience in the industry. I'm flying from New York to LA to Atlanta, and everybody's like, who's this songwriter from Ohio? I think I'm about to get this major publishing deal. I'm taking pictures. I had my hair fried back then. Some of you had your hair fried, so don't laugh. I had it fried, and God knows it was actually natural juices and berries I was squeezing. No, I had it fried. Had photo pictures and preparing for a showcase. You could not have told me that I was on my way. But it all came tumbling down to a screeching halt. The deals were off the table. There were others in the company that were signed, and all these publishing deals and production deals around me, but not me. I entered this state of depression, self-doubt. I turned to alcohol. I abused prescription drugs. I withdrew from my family. I quit my job. Like, you know something's wrong when you quit your job. That's stumbling blocks. I was a correction officer for almost 9 years with the state at the Department of Youth Services right there on Green Road. 13 years as a state employee. I even contemplated Bethany taking my own life. This is why, young people, you can't let anybody with a certain type fool you, because you'd be surprised. Because had I not told you that, you may not have thought that those were my stumbling blocks in 1997. Then I heard one night in this dream, after one of those prescription drugs mixed with alcohol, mixed with a little weed, and I'm sleeping, I can feel this demonic force pulling down on me, saying, and I hear these words just like I just heard that baby cry, you will be better off dead. And those around you will be better off too. So just do it. Finish that, them pills. Finish that, Paul Masson. Don't act like you don't know what Paul Masson is. You won't wake up. My best friend was my roommate. And in the dream, it was said to me, he'll find you. He'll call your kids. I see my son. But then I heard this sweet and gentle voice say, I will never leave you or forsake you. And that could not have been nobody but Jesus. And so I continued to call the name in my sleep, in the name of Jesus. And I felt this force go away. Well, he had no choice. as I felt the presence of the Lord pull me from that abyss that I was in, that I was sunken into. So I woke up with tears flowing in my eyes. Just woke up. I lived in this apartment with 147 kids. Woke up with tears flowing. And then I got out of bed. So my keyboard, something like that, was next to me. And a pen and paper was always near. And I sat and I wrote the words to the song, What God Has Done. Can I read the words to you? Do I have time? The words that came to me as soon as I woke up from what just seemed like a nightmare, it said, have you ever stopped to notice there's a lot going on out there? From the grass that's on the ground, no one's put down to the clouds up in the air. Have you ever seen a tree wake up in the spring and bear fruit by summertime? The sun is still going, and the stars are still showing, and the moon still finds the night. What I've seen, I can't explain, but I know from where it comes. It's like the sky that's over me. It's just a joy, young people, each day to see what God has done. Have you ever seen it rain? No two drops are the same. And where do rainbows go? Birds in the sky, they still love to fly in the world. The ocean holds. You ever heard the wind and looked around and then it's nowhere to be found? You heard a baby cry and look into his eyes, and a smile replaces a frown. I may not know how this is, but I know from where it's from. It's like the cloud that follows me. It's just a joy each day to see what God has done. I wonder from each hand, from which hand holds all the answers. And I wonder from which hand he spreads his amazing grace. Well, I hope to see his face one day and thank him for his son. And it's like the sky that's over me. It's just a joy each day to see what God has done. Bethany, young people, nothing in the world has ever convinced me otherwise that God himself did not place that song on my heart for a purpose greater, far greater than any record deal, movie contract, soundtrack. Because it restored my will to live and to carry on. For I would not be standing in the way. So, as I take my seat, young people, never give up. Be encouraged. And always acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. You are all to be congratulated, acknowledged, and honored. Not only this day, from this day on, for all of your accomplishments. And then this is only the beginning for what God has in store for you. You have found the feather. Now I just challenge you to bring back the bird with first believing in yourself as we collectively believe in you. And know that you can do all things in Christ that strengthens you. Realize, really awaken and release your God-given ability, your genius, your greatness. And never lose sight that greater is he that's in you than he that is in all the world. And finally, remember that there may be some stumbling blocks along the way, but they may actually be stepping stones as to where God would have you to be for his purpose. So, congratulations. You found the feather. Now bring back the word. That's my